I decided to do my self-change project on meditation. I thought I could use this very popular grounding technique to increase my focus, calm my chatty mind, and enable me to concentrate for longer. Well, full disclosure, I actually chose it because I thought I could cure my depression and anxiety, as well as all of the negative effects it has on my learning. It's tough to explain. People who've not experienced depression have difficulty understanding it, in the same way that someone without cancer doesn't understand the struggles associated with chemotherapy, or like those who've never given birth to children can't truly understand labor pain. With those two examples, though, people can generally understand that cancer has visible symptoms and are able to draw sympathy, that childbirth is excruciating and typically don't really want to imagine how awful it is because we've all seen labor in film and television, if not in real life. For depression, people jump to the association of feeling sad. It's not wrong as such, but sad is a healthy emotion that you feel for many reasons. In mourning, after rejection, in solidarity for a friend who didn't get the job they worked really hard for. The emotion of sadness is necessary to process an unhappy situation or encounter. It's healthy, it's normal, and it passes. Depression, for most people, and it does vary from person to person, is like a pit or a hole. It's dark, cold, and indescribably lonely. This pit or cave or hole is like an echo chamber of your worst thoughts and fears, ceaselessly reverberating from every wall. You're not enough. You're pointless. You're wasting space and air and resources. Why can't you get over this? Your husband is going to leave you. He didn't sign up for this. You exhaust your family and they can't deal with you anymore. No one loves you. No one loves this. You're useless and pathetic and a burden. You're a burden. You're a burden. A burden. And you can't turn it off. There's no off switch. It's this intrusive, negative self-talk that violates your mind and changes the way you think about everything. But no one can see it. It's so visceral to you. It's literally poisoning your mind and body, but no one else knows. So I thought that sitting on the ground or in my car listening to wind and perpetually cranky birds in the sweltering heat would somehow fix that. You're supposed to come up with a mantra, but mine sort of unintentionally turned into, oh my god, you're literally turning into a puddle person. I thought that if I could get into the habit of meditating, it would create some peace in my mind and that I might be able to focus better on schooling, on work, on everything. Then I might procrastinate less because I thought I deserved a good education, that I was worthy of it, and I suppose I envisioned the repetition of it or the habit of it would provide a solid routine. Unfortunately, I am very good at procrastinating and very good at negative self-talk, so getting over those hurdles were difficult. Strangely enough, I found a good way to get motivated was to trick myself into just starting. I'd tell myself I'm going to reread some work I've done or check some due dates on things, but once I sat down with the intention of schoolwork, I just sort of started doing it. Getting started was always, always the hardest part for me because I would work myself up envisioning this perfect finished piece and then I knew that I'd never be able to achieve that. So I would just start it late and then when it wasn't good enough, it wasn't my intellectual failure, it was that I started late. But then I started to get really sick with anxiety and even had a pretty bad relapse. So after that, I tried to remind myself that when I'm 65, retired, and cruising around the world, or Mars, I'm not going to look back on this moment and remember the shame I felt at being inadequate. I'll be on Mars. Who gives a f***? So I lessened the pressure on myself and just tried a little bit every day. It ended up adding up, and I finished all of my projects ahead of time, so now I'm caught up on Game of Thrones. So, being the perfectionist I am, I tried to record the data every day in this enormous, scary-looking spreadsheet that I designed for myself. It's actually kind of like a really technical diary, but with way less tear stains. Just kidding. I own tissues. I'm not a savage. I added to it every day, stating how long I meditated for and how I was feeling in general that day. Plus, whether I slept well or had bad or not bad dreams the night before. I wanted to see if meditating had any effect on both my conscious and unconscious self. I noticed that I would psych myself out sometimes when it came to sit down and meditate, so I changed my strategy and applied the meditation time to when I felt the most stressed out, which was usually before or between classes. I ended up sitting in my car for most of them and just chilling out before I tackled my next task, and I really felt like it made a difference, especially before tests. Did I accomplish my goal? I think so. I know right after I meditate, I feel a lot calmer, and over time I think it's made it easier for me to bring down the chatter in my brain and enable me to focus more on the task at hand, as well as in general just making me feel like, yeah, I can do this, what have I got to lose? Procrastinating, not eating, and oversleeping were the habits that seemed to affect my progress the most. I definitely need to be more self-disciplined and generally just responsible. It's easy to have the worst habits when you're the one holding yourself accountable. You slept in? Ah, well, you deserve it. You did 30 minutes of English. You should watch an hour of New Girl. I noticed when I asked my husband to help by holding me accountable for some things, like eating or getting up at a reasonable time, I found it harder to ignore when I was letting myself down if it felt like I was letting him down.
So tap me out and tap me into you. Heal my brain and my body too. Balance my chemistry, hydrate these cells, cause the body talks and meditation helps. The body talks and meditation helps.
I think I'll keep meditating. The one thing I've really learned from this experience is that I deserve to at least keep trying and to do my best, even if it's not perfection.